Hello and welcome to the big picture. After two decades of the existence of the collegium system of appointment of judges to the higher judiciary, the government has brought in a bill before the parliament to scrap the system and to set up a judicial appointments commission in its place. Over the last 20 years, there have been many critics of the collegium system as well as supporters. The critics have been pointing out that this system of judges appointing themselves was neither democratic nor healthy in a democratic society. On the other hand, the supporters of the collegium system insist that it is important to retain the independence of the judiciary. There have been many other arguments for and against the system and the need for a more broad-based judicial appointments commission. The government has finally managed to work out a consensus and bring it before the parliament. It may be recalled that this has been in the making for at least 10 years and has gone through various processes. We will discuss today the pros and cons of this bill and how much necessary it is to improve the system of appointment of judges. To discuss this, I have with me Soli Sorabjee, former Attorney General of India and a distinguished legal luminary, Prashant Bhushan, a leading lawyer and social activist, Manan Kumar Mishra, Chairperson of the Bar Council of India, and Satya, legal editor, Hindustan Times. Welcome to all of you. Mr. Sorabjee.
Yes.
Mr. Sorabjee, it is said that this bill, I mean, we all know that this has been in the making for a long time and finally this bill is in the parliament now. But do you think this is the bill which will bring about more transparency and accountability in the system as far as appointment of judges are concerned?
Well, I think the question should be whether the present system needs to be replaced.
Right, okay.
And what was the reason, what was the rationale of the present collegium system?
Right.
The idea was to have judges appointed with not merely ability, but of independence.
Right.
In other words, we didn't want what we call sarkari judges.
Right.
Pro-government judges.
Right.
Now, how did it arise? Because judges were superseded. Three judges were superseded because of judgments which the government didn't like.
Right.
Justice Khanna was superseded because of his judgment. Therefore, the necessity to ensure that judges who are appointed, apart from ability and integrity, will have the independence. They won't be pro-government judges.
Right.
Now, what happened, that was really the origin or the rationale of the collegium system.
Right.
But the collegium system, I must say, over the years, though I was a supporter of it, has not worked very satisfactorily. Another omission was that it was completely dominated by the judiciary.
Right.
I do agree judiciary must have a dominant voice, but can't have an exclusive voice. After all, government is the largest litigant, and there should be one member from the executive.
Right.
And that's what the bill provides.
Right.
That law minister, the minister in charge of law. To that extent, I think it's an improvement in the sense that there's no exclusivity in the judiciary.
Right.
And I don't understand two eminent persons. There are to be a pin. I don't know how the eminence is going to be gauged. In any case, that's the collusion of, I think, the Prime Minister, Chief Justice and Leader of the Opposition. So, well, this is supposed to meet the main difficulty about the collegium system was that there was no, the judges themselves appointed themselves. That was the main criticism.
Right.
To that extent, this helps it.
Right.
I don't know how it becomes transparency, but we are not going to show the recommendations. You said, who did they make? Why did it make one in favor of A, favor of B? Then it all be confidential.
Okay.
So that's what I have to say. I really don't know how this will really achieve the ultimate purpose. It may be a little improvement, but that's all.
Okay. Prashant, coming to you. You have been a very vocal advocate.
Yes.
We have been a very vocal advocate of changing the system. Does this bill, which is in the present form, which is now in the parliament, does that satisfy you?
No, not at all. In fact, it takes us one step backwards. You see, the original problem with the appointment of judges was that the whole system was non-transparent,
yes,
arbitrary, because there was no criterion in place, there was no system of shortlisting, there was no transparency whatsoever. And therefore it lent itself to arbitrariness.
Right.
In addition to that, because the appointments were controlled by the government,
yes,
it led to political appointments, as Mr. Sorabjee has told you.
Right.
When the collegium system was introduced, because the power of appointment was taken away from the government and vested essentially with the judges, the problem of political appointments to a large extent went away.
Right.
But the arbitrariness, non-transparency in appointments remained. Now, if you wanted to deal with these problems, you need to have a full-time independent judicial appointments commission,
yes,
which is independent of the government in order to preserve the independence of the judiciary, and also largely independent of the existing sitting judiciary. So it needs to be a full-time body, a broad-based full-time body, such as the similar to the Lokpal that we had proposed.
Right.
So therefore, instead of doing that, the government has proposed that this power of appointment should be shared between the government and the judiciary, without making the system of appointments more transparent, without having a full-time body which can go into the in the process of selection in a rational, systematic manner. In England, you have a Judicial Appointments Commission, which is a full-time body, which draws up a criterion which has more than 30 elements in that criterion.
Right.
On that basis, they call for advertisements, they call for nominations, they advertise for nominations. People nominate people. Thereafter, they are scrutinized on the basis of that more than 30 criteria. And then a very systematic selection is made. Nothing like this can happen in this system which is proposed, where you have sitting Chief Justice, sitting other judges of the Supreme Court, sitting Law Minister, who have plenty of other work on their hands. They have no time to devote to this process of systematic, rational selection of judges.
So you think,
therefore, this is going from the frying pan into the fire.
Okay. Mr. Sorabjee, would you quickly like to respond to that? You think what Prashant is talking about, a UK kind of system, is what we need, a full-time judicial commission to appoint judges rather than this kind of a system? Is it viable?
No, but I don't understand. What I want to understand, I want to ask my friend Prashant, by transparent, what does it mean? Names must be disclosed, reasons for non-recommendation must be disclosed, and as far as criteria are concerned, is mentioned there, if I mistake not, ability, integrity, and standing in the profession.
Right.
Those criteria are already there. Now, how you apply them is a different matter. One may
go wrong in applying them, but it's not criteria.
Yes, Prashant?
You see, transparency means that at least the shortlisted persons should be disclosed to the public on a public website, so that members of the public who have some relevant information about them can make that information available to the selecting authority. Today we have a large number of blackguards and scoundrels being appointed because their names are not being disclosed to the public, so that the public who has information about them, relevant information about them, that they have been involved in the following crimes, that they have been touts of the following judges, etc., they are not able to bring this information to the selecting authority. Nothing like that is there in this present bill.
Okay.
Now, the criterion that was mentioned is certainly not enough. Why is judicial temperament not a relevant criteria? Why is an understanding of the situation of common people in this country not a relevant criteria?
Okay.
In the UK, they have drawn up a list of 30 different characteristics they consider people.
No, Prashant, Mr. Sorabjee, don't you think that the present commission also... Okay, I think there is a problem with the audio. Come back to him. Yes, coming to you, Mr. Mishra. You're the chairman, chairperson of the Bar Council. The Bar Council seems to have a fundamental problem with this commission itself.
Yes. Actually, the Bar Council is completely opposing this National Judicial Appointment Bill. actually, we don't mean to say that this collegium system is perfectly all right. There are shortcomings.
Yes.
But this should not be replaced in this way. This commission, the idea of this commission, in the shape in which it has been placed, the involvement of the law minister,
yes,
the two eminent persons, yes, earlier it was the two eminent jurists,
right,
now it has become two eminent persons,
yes,
and the member secretary, the law secretary is to be the member secretary, he is also be a part of the collegium, this commission. Now we say that what is the actually the source from which the judges are being appointed, either from the bar, majority 60% from the bar, the others is from the lower judiciary.
Right.
Now the judges, they are the best persons to actually assess the merits, the ability, the knowledge of any member of the bar or the person of any lower judiciary. Therefore, the very purpose of that constitution bench judgment was in the Advocates on Records case,
yes,
that the judges, they know best, better about the merits and ability of a person who is going to be appointed.
No, fine. I understand your argument. But how do you counter the argument of both Mr. Sorabjee as well as Prashant, saying that in these last 20 years of its existence, they have found a lot of problems with the appointment of judges, as Prashant rightly said. Despite what you are saying, that yes, they should know that they are the best people to judge, there have been a lot of appointments which you, I'm sure you also agree, has not been the right kind of appointment.
No, that is there. The transparency should be there. That factor I agree. But they also say that this constitution of this commission is actually that cannot be accepted. The transparency should be there. There should be some criteria. And there should be an advisory body consisting of law minister, the representatives from the bar, the other social workers. They should be there to advise this collegium, present collegium. The transparency, I mean to say, it should be, I completely agree with my friend. He says that it should be notified who are the candidates.
Who are the shortlisted candidates.
Therefore, the public could also comment on it. There, I agree. But this, the way in which this collegium is proposed to be replaced, that is, we are strongly opposed.
We are strongly opposed to it. Yes, Seth Prakash. This debate has been going on. There has been a demand for this kind of a different kind of system, a collegium system, but the Bar Council is opposed to it. What is happening, between the bar and the bench?
Well, as Mr. Sorabjee pointed out, the earlier system, we are in fact heading towards a committed judiciary.
Yes.
There are lots of supersession of judges. In fact, there are lots of punitive transfers of judges. Those who delivered verdicts against government, they were transferred arbitrarily. So to salvage the situation, the judiciary came out with this collegium system.
Right.
And 1993, as we know,
right,
Advocates on Record judgment.
Right.
But then what is happening is this has proved to be, it's like the remedy is worse than
the disease.
And what is witness, we have witnessed in the last two decades is the judges, you have witnessed the phenomenon of appointing judges, and in the process what we have seen is lot of meritorious judges, genuine, honest and good judges, they have been overlooked, and those who have been recommended, they included Justice Dinakaran, they included Justice Soumitra Sen, these kind of people were appointed, and the executive didn't have any say. So the executive's interference, that was completely done away with, but at the same time, in the name of judicial independence, we installed a system which is not working well. What we have witnessed is 30% of the High Court judges' posts, they are lying
still vacant.
Vacant.
Actually,
why? Because the collegium system is not working well. There is a lot of, within the system, within the collegium, there is difference of opinion and they are not able to function properly.
Mr. Sorabjee.
And to add, the worst was there is complete, it's complete opaque system. There is no transparency at all.
Okay, Prashant. The existing system is opaque, the existing system. So you think that, this system cannot, you're talking of this 30 criteria which is laid out in UK. Why can't this commission, which is with the proposed commission, can also work out some kind of that kind of a, criteria which to appoint judges? Don't you think that can be the via media?
No, they can work out a criteria, but how will they apply it? They have no time. You see, an ex officio body of this kind, where you have the Chief Justice and two senior judges, then you have the Law Minister, then you have the Law Secretary. These persons have thousands of other things to do. The Chief Justice and two judges are more than overly busy in their judicial work. How will they examine? Every year about 60, 70 High Court and Supreme Court judges are to be appointed, which means that you must consider at least five times that number of people, at least 400-500 people. If you have to examine the credentials of 400-500 people on all the relevant criteria, you need a full-time body.
Okay, let
you
me.
You can't have an ex officio body doing this job in a rational manner. The appointments will be as arbitrary as they have been in the past.
As arbitrary and as delayed, Mr. Sorabjee, you think a full-time body is as Prashant talks about? Is that what is necessary? You think that is viable, that is rational, and you know, as Prashant points out, 500 to 600 people have to be judged in a year's time to appoint even 60, 70 people. This ex officio body will not be able to do that job.
Yes,
do you agree with that?
There is some force in Mr. Prashant Bhushan's argument, but I don't think this body will be unable to do it. After all, it has to make recommendations.
Right.
Now, I agree with it. Make it more broad-based. I agree with it. But I'm not in favor of public. Destroy judge, name of Judge A, there'll be 10 people supporting him, 20 people opposing him. Judge B, simple thing. Please keep the public outside. They will judge according to their prejudices, according to their experience before the judge. Right. Make it more broad-based. I agree with you. Bar Council of India, any other body.
Right.
And well, full time, I don't know how it will be done, but there's some force in Prashant Bhushan's argument, because after all, it's a very important function. If you appoint the right kind of judges, you won't have trouble afterwards in trying to remove them.
Right. Mr. Mishra, you think that this can be a via media out, a Bar Council member or a Supreme Court Bar Association member, make it broad-based, get more people onto this body?
That is our proposal.
Yes.
That is our proposal.
So you're actually not opposing this kind of a commission, but you're saying that it has to be broad-based.
No. We are in favor of strengthening the collegium itself by making it broad-based.
Okay.
And Bar Council of India, in fact, is proposing to go for a review for that constitution based judgment.
Let me get the opinion of the two. Mr. Sorabjee, here is the Bar Council of India chairman, Mr. Mishra here. He says that, broaden the existing collegium system itself, broaden the existing collegium system and, make it an advisory body to the collegium system. And, he's also talking of going in for a review of the 1993, the Advocates on Record judgment.
That's a different matter. Review is before the Supreme Court, the review won't review it. Suppose they don't. Idea is to really, in spite of the judgment, to do this. One question may be whether you can do it by a bill, only by a constitutional amendment.
Right.
But review is neither here nor there. Whole question is, experience has shown that system is not working satisfactorily, and try and make it less unsatisfactory by having some changes made. I don't think Law Secretary is a member, is he, Prashant? I don't think so. He's only a convener of the meeting.
Law Secretary is the convener of the meeting, yes.
No solution will be perfect. Let's improve upon the present thing. In the light of our experience, we can suggest something more. But one thing I'm very clear, I don't want public participation, because that won't be on the question of merits of the particular judge. It will be on the merits of the public perception of the judge's favorable judgment passed in favor of that person or that party and other factors.
Which
should not be really dealing with ability, integrity, standing, and I agree with Prashant to one extent. Another requirement should be independence.
Right.
The independence of the person is very important.
So you
may have ability, if it doesn't have independence, it's no use.
Mr. Sorabjee, so that this commission can itself draw up a list of priority, the parameters and like what the UK system has, then there shouldn't be no any problem drawing a parameter the way they function. Anyway, Mr. Prashant, you know, Mr. Sorabjee is completely against your idea of, you know, making it more transparent, put up these shortlisted candidates on the website, like, you know, invite public opinion about this. He says that it is going to create a huge lot of mess because, you know, people, there will be lot of biases, lot of prejudices, lot of personal problems of the people that can all come in, and, you know, it will only complicate the whole process.
No, if this argument were to be accepted, then we can't have persons being appointed to public offices at all, because appointment to a public office requires transparency. After all, it's the people of the country who are the real masters of this country. Are they not entitled to know who are the people who are going to be appointed to such high positions?
No, that's okay.
Who will make decisions of life and death over them, etc.
No, but
and if people are so diffident that they are afraid of public opinion, or they are afraid of what people say about them, then they don't need to be appointed to these posts.
No, Prashant, but do you agree that, you know, it can lead to a lot of delay, lot of, you know, prejudices coming in, lot of litigations? Don't you agree with that? I mean, and where is there any? Is there any? No, one second. Is there any? Is there any public body to which appointments are made through the system which you are talking about? Is there one?
Of course, in America, even the appointment of judges to the Supreme Court, there is a full public hearing.
That is right.
Where
that
anybody making any kinds of allegations can come and make those allegations with evidence, etc. That there is a public hearing which is gone through. So therefore, what is the problem in this?
Mr. Mishra, you think that kind
After
of a system
all,
can...
Okay, are the people of this country not entitled to know who are the persons being proposed to be appointed?
Okay, later, Mr. Mishra.
What will happen if somebody makes insubstantiated allegations? Then they will be eliminated by the appointments committee. Appointments committee will only take into consideration that information which is substantiated.
But Prashant, you know, it can only defeat the entire purpose of this kind of a commission, because it may cause further more delays than what we are having today. Mr. Mishra, would you support that kind of a system?
Certainly not. America, UK, we can't compare with India. We have different context to consider.
Quite right.
Now, simple thing, that it's the object of the commission which I have seen today in the Hindu, that it is the involvement of executive and there should be a transparency.
Yes.
For that purpose, either this commission or the collegium, if it is made some broad-based, the other advisory bodies are there to help it, this commission or the collegium.
No, that will do. No, Satya Prakash, the statement of object and reason is very clear. It wants the involvement of both the judiciary and the executive, and as somebody mentions, even the citizenry, because, you know, you're bringing in two eminent people also onto the panel.
Not only
so
that.
This argument of broad-based is actually dealt with
the involvement of bar. They have completely overlooked the bar. The commission, you will see.
What is the problem with the collegium system? First problem is that it's completely opaque.
Yes.
Does the new proposed system address this concern? It does not. Unless you make the system, I don't agree with Mr. Sorabjee.
Transparent. The question is about what is transparency. Now, is the transparency which Prashant Bhushan is talking about, which Mr. Sorabjee feels that, you know, it will only lead to a lot of mess
if you open it up to this kind of thing? Open it up. I'm saying, suppose you have selected or you have proposed five names. You make the names public. Let the people of this country, if they feel that there is anything against all these five people, they can write to the commission. And the commission can consider it. I'm saying, don't make it public. At least the commission must know who are the people being considered, and if the
commission will know
the allegations against these people, if there is anything against them,
I'm sure,
if because once you appoint them and thereafter you have Soumitra Sen type of situation where a case was pending against him, there was something against him, and nobody knew.
Sorabjee, at what level can there be a transparency? That is the question. at what, you know, at what level of the process can we have transparency?
Well, transparency in the sense that they would know who are the people who were not accepted, not recommended, who are the people who were recommended. But not further, not the reasons, not what happened. Look, one thing.
Yes.
If you want to make it broad-based, no difficulty at all.
Yes.
But let me tell me, Prashant, tomorrow you disclose the name of Mr. X as an appointee, there'll be 10 people opposing him, 20 people supporting him. Have we others? This is not election of judges. Neither in America. Yes. This is appointment. Public will have different ideas depending upon the experience, depending upon the prejudices, preconceptions. Don't bring the public in that way. Otherwise, almost saying they will elect the judges. People know. 10 people say, no, he's not a good judge. 20 people say, he's a good judge. And vice versa. Where do we go to? No. You have to trust the commission. Yes. As you say, if you want it, make it more broad-based, I don't mind. But not public.
Okay.
Yes. There is no... There will be a fluctuating public opinion depending on the experience of the particular people.
Okay. Yes.
Allowing the members of the public to say something about the names proposed, and that too to the commission, this is not election of judges. This is not American system. We are going to experiment a new system. Let it be a transparent system. Otherwise, I am afraid it will be worse than the previous system.
That will open up a floodgate for the litigation unnecessarily.
It will be like election.
In a matter of appointment.
What will open floodgates for
that some, if public opinion and open discussion is invited.
Takes place, then it will lead to
unnecessary
chaos.
Unnecessary, no appointment will be possible at all.
So, Prashant, see, there are two people who are both your professional colleagues feel that, you know, it, this kind of transparency which you are talking will only lead to further delays and further mess, and, you know, you won't be able to appoint, because the whole idea behind this, one of the ideas behind collegian system being scrapped and this being brought about is to improve the hasten the appointment process, and it may get further delayed.
No, once you have a full-time, that's why I'm saying that we need a full-time body for this job.
Yes.
You can't have this ex officio. See, if you have an ex officio body like this which functions without any transparency,
yes,
you will continue to have these kind of totally arbitrary nepotistic appointments. After the collegium system came into place, political influence was eliminated to a large extent. But all this arbitrariness, nepotism remained.
Okay.
Now the government wants to take a good share or a reasonable share of the power of appointments to itself, so that without eliminating arbitrariness, without introducing transparency, so what they want is that the same kind of arbitrary appointment should continue with the addition of some political influence also over the appointments. So now appointments will be shared between the government and the judiciary. Half political appointments will be made and half other arbitrary nepotistic appointments at the hands of the judiciary will be made without any system, without any transparency, without any criterion. This kind of thing will continue.
Okay. Okay. I think, Mr. Mishra, so last words to you. You think that at least this can start off, and whatever problems which arise over that, it can be corrected later?
You see, in this discussion also you will find there are different views. We have simply demanded from the government, from the Honorable Law Minister, that this is a very crucial issue. This should be discussed properly. There should be a necessary seminar.
But it has been, 10 years. It has been in the discussion for 10 years, Mr. Mishra. Don't you think enough discussion has not been
only had? Within 2 months we have seen three types of change drafts.
Okay. I think on that note we need to end. Anything new which is brought about is bound to have these kind of differences. But now that the bill is in the parliament, it will have to be discussed there. Let us see if during the discussions any more amendments will be brought into the bill, and how it will, what kind of a final shape it will take when it comes out of the parliament. Thanks to all my guests, Mr. Soli Sorabjee, Prashant Bhushan, Mr. Manan Kumar Mishra, and Satya Prakash. Please keep watching. We'll come back with another issue on the Big Picture same time tomorrow.